Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Self and Identity, The Basics, by Megan E. Birney. Narrated by Lianne Walker. 1. Defining the Self. Box 1.1. Who am I? Ask yourself the question, who am I? Then write down the first five things that come to your mind. Try not to spend more than a couple of minutes deciding what to write. Who am I? At some point or another, most everyone has asked themselves this question. If you took part in the activity in Box 1.1, there is huge variety in the answers you could have given. You might have listed your family role or your job title. You might have described your personality, your hobbies, or stated demographics such as your nationality, religion, or gender identity. You might have written your name. The ability to reflect on who we are is something that makes human beings unique from other mammals. In the same way that you don't have to understand how the respiratory system works to breathe, selfhood is automatic for most animals. For humans, however, the question, who am I, is one that anthropologists believe we've been grappling with since our days as hunters and gatherers. Yet there remains no universal definition of the self, nor is there an agreed consensus about what exactly selfhood is. Still, the concept of self and the theorising around it has shaped disciplines ranging from theology to biology to political science, to name a few. As we will learn from this chapter, the literature on the self is vast. It spans thousands of years and covers what feels like just as many perspectives. In this book, we take a specific view of the self. Drawing on the field of social psychology, we examine selfhood using the social identity approach. But before we delve into this view, we will spend this chapter touching on just some of the different perspectives of the self from Western philosophy and psychology. We will then consider modern beliefs about the self, that is, true self-beliefs, and how these influence our thinking and our behaviour. Importantly, the conceptual frameworks provided in this chapter will help to set the stage for the rest of this book, where we will be thinking about the self as a function of identity. Philosophical notions of the self. One area that has had a clear impact on our understanding of selfhood is Western philosophy. After all, quotes referring to the self, such as "know thyself" and "I think, therefore I am," have been known in popular culture for centuries. Before we delve into some of these ideas, it is important to note that in this literature, the terminology used to describe selfhood varies. The word self can refer to our biological existence. The word mind might describe the part of us that perceives stimulus and initiates action. And the word soul often includes our religion or moral compass. When considering the context in which these words were used, it is likely that they all referred to what we describe today as selfhood. In philosophical terms, the soul, the mind, and the self all describe our ability to think, that is, to reason, to analyse, and to imagine. Unlike the body, which is constantly changing, the self is believed to stay relatively stable. From this perspective, it is the self that makes up our being. A very short overview of key ideas in Western philosophical thinking about the self demonstrates how complex the ideas about selfhood are. One concept of self is that of dualism, the idea that humans consist of both the body and the soul, and that the two exist independently from each other. It is believed that Socrates saw the soul as the moral and intellectual essence of human beings. He emphasised the importance of self-examination and the acquisition of knowledge to live a meaningful life. That is, the good life, as he called it. This idea is articulated in his famous quote, The unexamined life is not worth living. In what was revolutionary for the time, Socrates believed the state of one's soul was more important than material riches, status, or reputation. Socrates' student, Plato, largely agreed with him, but took the concept of the soul as a separate entity from the body further. He argued that humans have three souls: the rational soul, which allows you to reason, the spiritual soul, which gives you emotion, and the appetitive soul, which regulates your body's basic needs. For him, the rational soul is superior because it can control the other two. To illustrate this, imagine you are out on a walk and you start to feel cold. You pass someone who has a coat for sale, but you don't have any money with you. The fact that you would continue to feel cold rather than stealing the coat is an example of your rational soul superseding the spiritual and appetitive souls. For Plato, the rational soul is one's true self and, importantly, can live forever. After the body dies, it finds another body to inhabit. These ideas mirror those of reincarnation, the belief that a being's spirit inhabits another body upon death. Other famous dualists include Augustine, whose thinking on the self would have been heavily influenced by the advent of modern Christianity. Sainted by the Catholic Church in 1303, Saint Augustine believed that while the soul is immortal, it does not inhabit different bodies as suggested by Plato. Rather, the soul unites with the body to complete us as human beings. Because he believed that humans were created in God's image, he believed that the only way to really know and understand oneself is to know and understand God. Nearly 2,000 years later, another famous philosopher, René Descartes, would take a different approach in his reasoning for the existence of a separate mind and body. Famous in part for his rational approach to questions and as the creator of deductive reasoning, Descartes acknowledged that because the mind cannot be observed, it is impossible to study it objectively. For Descartes, then, proof of the mind's existence lies in our ability to doubt. He claimed that even if we are tricked into believing that we are not real, the fact that we have these thought processes at all proves that ourself is in fact a real entity. Not everyone subscribed to the concept of dualism. Plato's own student, Aristotle, disagreed about the body's connection to the soul. For him, the soul is a form of the body. It is what gives the body life, and therefore it dies when the body dies. He argued that all living things have a soul. Plants have a vegetative soul that allows them to grow and reproduce. Animals have a sensitive soul, which gives them feeling and sensation. And humans have a rational soul, which is unique in giving us the ability to think. Much later, David Hume would take a different stance entirely on the question of how the self is relevant to the body. For him, the self is not real. Rather, it is an illusion and only exists through the senses. He argued that although we have a concept of the self, this does not mean that the self is real. In what some might consider a compromise between Aristotle and Hume are the ideas put forward by Immanuel Kant. Kant claimed that we have an inner self, that is, our rational thought, and an outer self, that is, our senses, that make up who we are. For him, these two cells unite to make us aware of our moral obligations. Recent theorising about selfhood has considered the emphasis in modern day on how the individual relates to their own thinking and observations of the world. One particularly influential modern philosopher is Charles Taylor. According to Taylor, who we are is determined by our morality. Importantly, selfhood is established not just from acting moral, but by being moral. In this way, we cannot separate who we are from what we consider to be good or right. Of course, Our morality depends on our perspective or framework, that is, what we consider to be good and how we relate to that good. As an example, one of the 5 British values taught in British schools involves tolerance of those with different backgrounds or faiths. For people in Britain, then, this framework might guide moral thinking and, by extension, selfhood. From Taylor's perspective, this helps to explain why religion tends to play such an important role in determining how we conceptualise a self, as it is often religion that guides our moral framework. Even if we don't subscribe to a particular religion as an individual, we are still influenced by the religious makeup within our culture. Interestingly, at least from a social psychological perspective, is the emphasis Taylor places on the role of others. For him, morality, and hence the self, is intertwined with our obligation to others in our social world. For instance, someone who has a talent for teaching has a moral obligation to use that talent for the betterment of others. He also acknowledges that others validate us and, as such, play an essential role in helping us realise who we are. For instance, losing your framework because of rejecting church teachings, for example, or failing to have oneself acknowledged by others, can lead to intense feelings of confusion. This idea that who we are is dependent on other people is an overarching theme in this book. Psychological notions of the self. One key contribution of psychology to our understanding of the self is its use of empirical testing. Through this, psychologists have evidenced the influence that external factors, such as unconscious bias and social conditioning, have on who we are. Still, there remains no agreed definition of the self within the field. Depending on your view, selfhood can be subjective based on what we are individually aware of, for example, the experiential perspective, our genetics, for example, the biological perspective, or the way we have been rewarded and punished throughout our lives, for example, the behaviourist perspective. It might also emerge from unconscious thought, for example, the psychodynamic perspective, or be construed from messages received from society, for example, the social constructionist perspective. Yet, even within these perspectives, the literature on the self is vast. Take social psychology as an example. In the Handbook of Social Psychology, the index contains over 60 entries for the word self. Psychology's theorising about selfhood starts with one of the field's first ever books, Principles of Psychology by William James. In his seminal chapter about the self, James separates the I as a subject and the me as an object. He proposes that the I acts as an administrator for the me in that it controls, critiques, develops, and represents it. James proposed that the I reflects on itself to gain an understanding of who and what it is. For instance, if I find myself feeling nervous in social situations, my I might conclude that my me is shy. Of course, much of what it uses to interpret the me comes from the social world. James proposed that in addition to a material me, for example, our home and possessions, and a spiritual me, that is, how we perceive our abilities, values, and motives, we all have a social me that is concerned with how we are seen by others. This includes not only our actual reputation, but our perception of what others think about us. As most of us can probably relate, this latter concern, how we think we are seen by those around us, can be just as, if not more, important as people's actual opinions. In this book, we take an approach that considers the social me as paramount for determining selfhood. Perhaps psychology's most well-known theory of the self is Sigmund Freud's psychoanalytic theory. Freud believed that we face constant conflict between three different selves that each have different needs. The id is our drive for immediate satisfaction without regard for consequences. It is primal and animalistic in nature. The superego sets out what is usually an unattainable standard of law and morality. The ego is our rational thought and negotiates between the two. To illustrate how this works, imagine that you are hungry. The id might tempt you to binge on chocolate, while the superego might berate you for even considering eating an unhealthy food. The ego is faced with reconciling these two competing selves, a challenge made even more difficult by the varying states of consciousness each self exists in. For Freud, the id is unconscious, while the ego and the superego operate at both the conscious and the unconscious level. Although Freud pioneered the idea that we are often unaware of key elements ourself, he still acknowledged the importance of others. As an example, he described the ego as that part of the id which has been modified by the direct influence of the social world. The final theory we will detail in this section is Erik Erikson's 8 stages of psychosocial development. Erikson proposed that who we are is a constant balance between our psychological needs as individuals and the demands of our social world. Between infancy and older age, people are faced with various challenges, or crises, as he called them, that must be resolved to maintain a healthy ego. This is particularly difficult during adolescence, when young people are transitioning from childhood to adulthood. Because young people are facing questions about everything, from their future occupation to their sexuality to their politics, Erikson theorized that it is during this crisis that the question, "Who am I?" surfaces for the first time. To facilitate an answer, teenagers may try out different personas and experiment with playing new roles within their social worlds, sometimes to their parents' dismay. While the "Who am I?" question may never truly get resolved, completion of this stage is marked by a virtue that Erikson called fidelity, which he described as the ability to sustain loyalties pledged in spite of inevitable contradiction of value systems. In other words, the best outcome of this stage is that young people emerge secure enough with who they are to maintain genuine relationships with others and to feel a part of their communities. Humanistic notions of selfhood contrast these early ideas with more optimism about the self. Rather than seeing the self as in constant conflict or as facing constant crisis, humanists propose that a true self lives within all of us. While uncovering it requires hard work and perseverance, success results in joy and feeling satisfied within our lives. Today, belief in the existence of a true self, or true self-beliefs, is embedded in our thinking, not just in the West, but around the world. In the next section, we consider how believing in a true self guides our beliefs and our behaviours, both of which influence who we are. Indeed, we will be revisiting this cyclical relationship between what we believe about ourselves and how we think and behave throughout this book. True self-beliefs. One challenge when discussing the self is that it's a word that describes multiple concepts. Writings in both philosophy and psychology use it to refer to both the mass of cells that make up our bodies, that is, what happens within the skin, and another self that consists of our essence. This latter concept is known as the true self, but is sometimes called the real self, the essential self, and the ideal self, among others. Defining the true self is difficult, but we can think of it as the part of us that feels authentic. Belief in the existence of a true self echoes some of the ideas outlined in the previous section. When realized, the true self leads us to a fulfilling life. If you think about it, you likely believe in a true self without necessarily being aware of it. For instance, have you ever given the advice to be yourself? Or decided to forgive another person because you believe that whatever they did was not reflective of who they really are? As we will learn in this section, the idea that people have a true self permeates our everyday thinking and as such guide how we navigate the social world. Popular culture is rife with examples of a true self. One that is often used in text about the self is Alice in Wonderland. This classic story makes numerous references to different themes related to selfhood. Consider when the caterpillar asks Alice, "Who are you?" And Alice answers, I hardly know, sir, just at present. At least I know who I was when I got up this morning, but I think I must have changed several times since then. Exemplifying Charles Taylor's emphasis on the importance of one's moral framework in shaping their self, this scene illustrates how a change in our social world can alter our understanding of who we are. References to the existence of a true self can be found in movies from The Matrix, where Neo embarks on a journey that finds him discovering a genuine existence, A Christmas Carol, where Ebenezer Scrooge transforms from his miserly ways to a true self that is generous and empathetic, to Grease, where Sandy leaves her true innocent and sweet self behind to impress her peers with a new bad girl image. The idea that each of us has a true self is a prevalent theme within many areas in society, from wellness advice to television commercials. One theme underlying these portrayals is that people's true self is both good and moral. Generally, positive behaviours are perceived as reflecting who a person truly is. When a person's behaviour goes from negative to positive, it is seen less as a change and more as an uncovering of their true self. Conversely, negative behaviours are generally attributed to a person's surface or false self. The importance of virtue as part of the true self becomes clear when you consider that more than other traits, morality is believed to be at the core of who we are. It is also the most important factor in shaping our impressions of others. Of course, whether a behaviour is considered moral depends on perspective. A person who believes that abortion is wrong will be more likely to attribute the decision not to have one as reflecting a woman's true self, compared to someone without such views. Along these same lines, researchers found that people who identify as liberal are more likely to view sexual attraction to a person of their same sex as reflecting one's true self, compared to people with other ideologies. While some evidence suggests that we see our own true selves as superior to others, we tend to believe that all true selves are good and moral. These convictions appear in both Western and Eastern cultures. While there may be variations between which behaviours are considered moral and good, the belief in a righteous true self seems universal. Given how prevalent these beliefs are, the implications they have for our thoughts, feelings, and behaviours are immense. For instance, because true selves are understood as fundamental within human beings, and these are assumed to be both good and moral, we may be inclined to give others the benefit of the doubt. In other words, if we believe that a person's negative or immoral behaviours do not represent who they really are, we might feel it is right to forgive them even if they have acted abhorrently. The excuses made available by the supposed existence of a true self can also be applied to our own behaviours. Our belief that our true self is more virtuous than our actual self gives us a reason to minimise our own poor behaviour because we can rationalise that a better person lives within us. From a more positive perspective, it is also possible that a belief in a good and moral true self means that we strive for our actions to uphold that standard. Researchers have pointed to several benefits that can be gained when people feel in touch with their true selves, including greater resilience, stronger relationships, and higher motivation. There is also evidence that when we believe we have been guided by our true selves, we feel more confident in our decisions. While many of us will recognise the positive emotions that come with feelings of authenticity, the implications of true self-beliefs can also have more subtle consequences for our actions. For instance, Strominger and colleagues argue that these beliefs might explain people's reluctance to take medication designed to regulate traits that are seen as integral to the true self, for example, mood, but show less hesitancy taking medication to improve traits considered more peripheral, such as concentration or memory. The literature on true self-beliefs exemplifies a key theme within the social identity approach to understanding the self. How we perceive ourself and others plays an integral role in shaping how we think, feel, and behave. In the next section, we break down some key aspects of the self and consider how these relate to the social world. Self and identity. Most of us can probably observe that our self is subject to constant change. Whatever your perspective is on selfhood, who you are as a child is not the same as who you are as an adult. Even in adulthood, most of us would agree that when we experience a major life event, such as becoming a parent or experiencing trauma, we feel changed somehow compared to who we were before the event. At any given time, how we think about ourselves or what we think about who we are relies on our self-concept. This might include aspects of our personality. For example, I'm funny. Our feelings. For example, I'm sad. And our beliefs. I'm a liberal. When thinking of your answer to the question, who am I, you might have engaged in further reflection. For instance, through questions such as, how do I know who I am? And how do I feel about myself? The concepts that these questions tap into, for example, outside influences and our self-esteem, intertwine to give us a sense of what makes us unique as an individual. Your answers to these have also probably changed over the course of your life. My responses to these questions 20 years ago are not the same as how I would answer them now. This is because our experiences have a profound impact on who we are, our view of the world, our priorities, and, by extension, ourself. It is these experiences that result in what psychologists call as our self-schemas. A schema is an important concept in psychology. It is defined as a cognitive structure that represents our understanding of a concept or social stimulus. Schemas serve as cognitive shortcuts that help us make sense of all the stimuli we are faced with as we navigate our social world. When confronted with social stimuli, we only have limited information and limited time to process that information, so we rely on schemas to guide our thinking. Generally, we develop our schemas from previous experiences and by accumulating cultural knowledge. For instance, you may have never attended a lecture at university before, and yet, on the first day, you were aware of how you should behave in one. Likewise, if you are invited to a birthday party, you know a present may be expected without this being explicitly stated. Schemas come in different forms. Person schemas contain your knowledge about specific people. For example, dads like to tell bad jokes. Role schemas represent your knowledge about what is appropriate based on people's positions. For example, your lecturer can teach you but not shout at you. And event schemas include your knowledge about how to behave while in your immediate social environment. For example, you can scream at a football match, but not while travelling on the train. As you can probably guess, self-schemas contain the specific knowledge we have about ourselves. Like other schemas, these are influenced by the social world in which we live. To illustrate the power of this relationship, ask yourself to describe a university student. Some characteristics that come to mind might include the following. Students revise and attend lectures. They are young. They sleep in late. They go on nights out and drink alcohol. They eat baked beans and pot noodles. You may have listed these attributes without much thought because they are in line with many people's person schemas regarding students. But now, consider whether your list describes you as a student personally. From my perspective as an academic, this description does not apply to most students. Many of the students I've worked with over the past 10 years are not regularly staying out late drinking, nor are they sleeping until noon. Rather, they have sacrificed a lot to come to university and take the opportunity for education seriously. They are balancing their course commitments with paid work and family life. Increasing numbers are middle-aged and older and are returning to education after gaining invaluable life experiences. Still, the caricature of young, partying students is largely accepted, even among the members of this group that embody the opposite. Knowledge gained from the social world feed our self-schemas, which in turn make up our self-concept. As in the previous example, an older student might not be as proud of this part of their self because of their person schema that university students have just finished school. Hence, they might feel they are somehow behind their younger colleagues. In many ways, our self-schemas are tied to our self-esteem or how we evaluate ourselves as positive or negative. Researchers generally categorise self-esteem along two dimensions. Efficacy-based self-esteem is the extent that we see ourselves as capable, while worth-based self-esteem is concerned with feeling valued and accepted. Just as our self-schemas inform our self-esteem, our self-esteem informs our self-schemas. For instance, if you have a self-schema that you are bad at sport, but you desire to be athletic.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.